I'm Andrew from Creative Guitar Studio, and there was a question that was sent in from Joey out in New York, and he says here, I've been searching for a good lesson about a concept called pitch axis theory, but I cannot find one that explains how to use it. Most of the stuff I found just goes on about modes, but doesn't really cover how the shredder guys and the fusion guys actually use this concept musically. Can you please do a lesson about this topic? I really want to know more about it. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to cover a concept called pitch axis. And if you're not too familiar with it, pitch axis is the idea of playing under one droning pitch with more than one scale type. And this doesn't necessarily have to be restricted to just, you know, modes of the major scale. It can include other scales. But the principle is pretty much all the same. There's one droning pitch that remains constant in the bass. And we're going to even take this one step further. And under that drone pitch, we will have a series of other chords that will begin to influence harmony in one way or the other. So for our example, we will be looking at a progression that will keep a D pitch droning in the bass. And under that droning D, we'll be performing several different chords that will offer an opportunity up for us for different types of scales to be played. So let's begin by zooming in on the fingerboard and taking a close look at the chords that we'll be playing under that droning D bass note. The first chord that we have in our progression is a D major 9 sharp 11. Now to make this chord, basically what you're going to do is start off with your middle finger on the 5th fret of the 5th string. You'll have your index finger, it will actually be barring, but we'll get to that in just a moment. The next note that we're going to take a look at is with the baby finger there on the 3rd string 6th fret, and then the ring finger will be up on the 5th fret of the 2nd string. Now the idea that I want you to get across here with this index finger is we're going to need to bar with this finger because we need both the major 3rd as well as the G sharp up here on 1st string 4th fret, which is the sharp 11 of the chord. So if you bar, you get all those tones, you know, no problem. Now, the second chord of our progression is a D dominant 9, and the way we're going to do it is just use a standard dominant 7th shape, much like you'd have with a basic C major chord, turning it into a dominant 7th and then sliding it up basically a whole step to 3rd position. And what we get there is the dominant 7th with the ring finger on the 5th string 5th fret, middle finger on the 4th string 4th fret, the baby finger will be on the 3rd string 5th fret, and index will be on the 3rd fret of the 2nd string. Now how we get the dominant 9 out of this is we're going to actually include an open 1st guitar string here. So with that open string being an E, that's the 9 of the chord. Okay, our next chord that we're going to move into is in 1st position, and basically I wrote it on my chart as a D minor 9 sharp 5. That's kind of a chord though that really doesn't show up in harmony or anything. It's I guess it's like a minor altered or augmented, but I mean it's still, it's sort of a phony chord in a sense. But basically, you know, I think on most charts you'd see this as a B flat, because we're going to do it with the triad of B flat and then D in the bass. So it's basically one of those triad with bass note chords. So what really happens with this though is, see, we have the minor 3rd of D up here at the F. We have another octave of D here on the 3rd fret of 2nd string. But this sharp 5 tone, you got to remember the enharmonic equivalent of a sharp 5 is a flat 6. So, you know, with the minor 3rd and the flat 6 and of course the root of D, we get a pretty solid Aeolian mode or natural minor scale effect out of this chord. And then in the next measure afterward, we're going to move into a D minor 7. Okay, so it really solidifies that Aeolian mode sound. And then after that, we're just going to play a standard, you know, D minor, D major chord. Now, one thing I wanted to mention though about this D minor 7 is it'll look to a lot of people quite a lot like a standard F major chord, but it has a D in the bass. So that's essentially the idea there. You have to bar, you know, make sure your knuckle's flat on that index finger for the barring effect to really hold true and get both those notes. You have to really arch the knuckle as well, that middle finger, so you can get a proper tone happening off that 3rd string 2nd fret. Now, the last chord is just a standard D major that you'd have out of, you know, any kind of your beginner chord books. It's a fairly, you know, standard shape. Very common shape. So his index finger on the 3rd string 2nd fret, ring finger on the D note at the 3rd fret of the 2nd string, and then middle finger up on 2nd fret of 1st string. So now let's go through these chords in a little bit more detail and talk about what we're going to use to play over top of each one. Now, when I recorded the jam track for this, I did give two measures per chord, so there's quite a bit of time there for you to be able to get into your scale and start making some melody as each of these chords change, and you have to change the scale type that's used to play over them. Let's start the first chord though. The first eight beats, we're dealing with a major chord with a sharp 11, which is sort of your deadpan giveaway that you're dealing with Lydian mode. Now, if you're familiar with Lydian mode, then you'll know that it has a sharp 4, and if you're familiar with your theory on compound intervals, you'll also understand that the 11th is the same thing as a 4th, but up an octave. So sharp 11 is the real giveaway that we've got a solid footprint here of Lydian mode. We're gonna play that for the first eight beats. Then we're gonna move on, and in the next eight beats, the next two measures, we're just gonna switch over to Mixolydian. We have a dominant chord there, so dominant seventh chords can really promote the use of Lydian mode quite clearly. Then we move to the next two measures, and in these measures, we've got a minor chord show up. But the unique thing here, though, and I want to talk about it for a moment, is that sharp 5. Now, a sharp 5 is the equivalent of a flat 6, which is one of the main color tones of Aeolian mode. So that really anchors in that color right away. And, the thing that's getting away from, basically, is from us really being able to use Dorian mode there. We could have changed this interval. We could have done something here. We could have maybe made this a minor 6 chord, for example, and then we would be using Dorian instead of Aeolian. But seeing as how it has the sharp 5 against that D root, that's really creating, again, a real solid footprint of the use of Aeolian mode there. And then because we have a direct quality change, we're dealing in minor and then directly shifting into major. This is a D major chord now for these last two measures. It's enough of an impact that we can actually go into the basic Ionian mode, and it creates a real solid landing into the world of basic major scale. So that's what we're just going to be using there, the major scale in those two measures. And if you find this too difficult to do, I mean, it's a lot of different modes. If you're unfamiliar with modes or you're just studying them now, this may be a fairly challenging thing to be able to play over. So, you may want to, just basically learn the chord types and re-record them into maybe only using a couple of these changes and start slower and, build yourself up to being able to do all four of these modes over these changes. Well, as you can probably tell, pitch axis theory has quite a lot to do with playing modal, and if you didn't happen to notice, the use of each mode is essentially dictated by the chord that happens to be performed at the moment. So when a specific chord occurs, there's a corresponding mode that can be used for creating melody, whether that's going to be through composition or through improvisation. But overall, this requires a pretty solid understanding of the use of modes, and when you begin to play music this way, there's also important work that you'll want to focus on in the department of developing both your pentatonic scales as well as your use of arpeggios to a fairly high level. It's a bit of work. It takes an awful lot of time, practice and patience, but it does come slowly and it's worth it down the line. It's very rewarding when you can do this kind of thing well. So thanks for the question, Joey. You're gonna receive a free download of the jam track that I made for this video. And until next time, everybody keep jamming out, and I'll catch up with you on the next video. Bye for now.